The government in its budget, of course, announced that it was allocating funds to Gunnins for railway cars. That contract was signed 2 years ago, and it's part of a projected contract. It's not good news for the Hunter. It's something that it was good news 2 years ago. It was we were very pleased about it 2 years ago. But that's old news, and it's not part of this 1984-85 budget. It was really part of a previous budget. Obviously, funds still have to be allocated down the track in accordance with the contract. That's the sort of news we're getting too often. We're getting a repeat of previous commitments that have been made, and the Chamber of Commerce and Industry are no longer going to sit back and just accept this. We're going to press our case. We're going back through our submission to the state government, and the members of the board of the Chamber are determined to go into great detail to ensure that the message is made, given to the government, that our treatment is not acceptable.
Wales completed its innings today at 9 declares for 409 after being 6 down for 382 overnight. Greg Matthews was best with 138. With 20 minutes lost by rain, but still an hour of the second day of 3 to go, the home side was 3 down for 202, with Rick McCosker on 87 and Eric Higgins on 38. The story though in the match is being centred around the Newcastle legend, Robert Dutchie Holland, selected into the state side and not used, a fact that has irked local officials. Believe it or not, state captain Dirk Wellham first used the wily spinner in the 66th over of the innings. Holland has the talent, but must be pondering his future, a future that could include a green and gold cap, but only if he gets a go.
For the movie Big Foot, the way out Chev El Camino Ute won the title of four-wheel driver of the year at the Los Angeles Auto Show. Now it's to go on a tour of shopping centers, beginning with Garden City. Its remarkable tires, fittingly branded Monster Mudders, purchased high enough to hold a party underneath. For the driver, the trick is to avoid trampling lesser machinery underfoot.
Well, the VWs go straight under, you don't even notice them as they go under. It's not a good thing, you might.
This particular seminar will last until tomorrow and is one of 18 conducted by the New South Wales Government throughout the state. The group will attend a series of lectures over the next 2 days, designed, according to the Director of the Office of Aged Services, Ms. Jane Chin, to gather information to be incorporated into policy on provision of services for the aged. The seminar yesterday was officially opened by the member from Mason, Ms. Alan Ward, and afterward Ms. Chin agreed that in the past, the elderly had been disillusioned by government news.
Yes, and I should rightly say that they haven't been recognised as a group, and at the same time their views haven't been sought. With an ageing population, that view is changing. Elderly people have a voice at the marketplace and they also have a voice at the ballot box. And it's important that New South Wales and other states in Australia provide for delivery of services in the most efficient and effective manner.
To finalise plans for a long away to the highway, the Federal Station is just
the
residents that the highway was a for the lower 100 development. Mr Morris, however, commented later that he felt the residents didn't fully understand the plan.
The confusion about access to water was based upon the old plan, where it was intended the National Highway Terminus would virtually end at Wall's End, and that would be the case for the end of the century. This strategy we're putting forward now is for the National Highway to bypass Wall's End, go straight through along the upgrade of Minmai Road to the New England Highway by 1988, so that the access from the Selville beyond Wall's End to the National Highway means that a lot of the traffic that was contemplated years ago would go into Wall's End would not, under this strategy, go into Wall's End. It's a quite different thing.
There are two points put forward. One is that,
however, did not agree.
That still means that the majority of the traffic which could have used a national highway, and much of this is local generated traffic, such as the heavy coal trucks and signs, which have been complaints in Newcastle for many years, could have been brought onto this same section of road had there been earlier planning between, say, the State Department, the local council and the Fed to come up with a route that let interstate traffic, as well as a lot of this heavy local traffic, avoid the streets of the western suburbs of Newcastle.
Well, is that the view of most of the residents?
The residents who have taken a close look, yes, that's their reaction, because they are aware that this is recycled information and that they're not confused with the old scheme. They appreciated when this came out that there was that new factor to it, and we're pleased to see that.
The Rugby League Forum last night discussed many and varied problems that confront the league at this time. The meeting was attended by club administrators, players and referees, and some members of the public. The occasional people said that the problems were brought out into the open. Subjects such as what grade should be played in 1985 in both senior and junior football, and allocation of fixtures came under discussion. Refereeing problems also came onto the agenda, as the talk of a local transfer and import rules. Club boundaries within the local competition caused some heated debate, as well as the admission sizes, ground facilities, and the financial ability of local clubs. Officials stressed, however, that the meeting was not designed to make any decisions, but simply as an exercise in formulating the policies for the future.
Following the breaking of the supply.
Reef Primary School was just one of more than 150 schools in the region taking part this year. The competition was held this morning for students in Year 5 and 6, and all up, more than 6,700 students racked their brains over the 30-question paper. While school mathematics itself has changed vastly since the days of the three R's, don't think the computer has taken over. In today's competition, calculators weren't used. For the children taking part, most interest is now in whether or not they've won one of a number of cash prizes or certificates. But for the competition officials, the hard work is just starting. After they've processed the results, ironically on a computer, they'll then inform the schools of the results. At this stage, they're anybody's guess, but that's not mathematics.
...36-year-old Philip Bird from Taro was working underground in the mine. Police say at about 7 o'clock this morning, a large piece of rock from the seam fell and struck him on the head and shoulders. He was taken from the mine by a mine's rescue team. The rescue helicopter transported the man to Royal Newcastle Hospital with suspected spinal injuries. His condition is reported to be satisfactory. A 30-year-old engine driver employed by the State Rail Authority was killed at Shelfide Junction this morning after being hit by an express train. Philip Roach from Beresfield was moving trains on the track between Cardiff and Cockle Creek stations. He alighted from the train he was shunting to check a coupling. Police say Roach was hit by the North Coast Express at 3:30 a.m. and was killed instantly. The accident caused delays to some trains using the line today. The second accident happened just after 7 o'clock this morning at the Stockton Borehole Colliery at Toowoomba. 36-year-old Philip Bird from Taro was working underground in the mine. Police say a large piece of rock from the seam fell and struck him on the head and shoulders. He was taken from the mine by a mine's rescue team. The rescue helicopter then transported Bird to Royal Newcastle Hospital with suspected spinal injuries. His condition is reported to be satisfactory.
Say that the New South Wales government has announced that they're abolishing, much the word abolishing, stamp duty on the transfer of debentures, notes, etc., etc. And this is certainly a welcome and long overdue move, and one that was fully expected. It's quite obvious that we've matured quite dramatically in recent years in the sense of investment sophistication, and full marks to the New South Wales government for leading the field. I don't think it'll be very long before the Victorian government and other governments follow suit. Now what this means is, and I'll quote the existing situation, if you want to buy or sell company debentures through the stock market, the secondary market as we say, the buyer will pay 30 cents for every $100 worth involved, and the seller will also pay 30 cents in stamp duty for every $100 worth involved. Now that's 60 cents per $100 worth. It may not seem much, but it certainly didn't appeal to people in the course of changing over from one type of debenture to another or in selling. So what the government is doing is creating a very important secondary market. Now, from the personal point of view, and this is the thought of this morning, I want you to note, and whether you pay stamp duty or not really is irrelevant, how you hold your existing, say, AGC debentures, Standard Chartered Finance debentures, Elders debentures, Beneficial debentures, Custom Credit debentures, etc., etc. Because if you're holding them in joint name, and you're a taxpayer, e.g., the husband, and your wife isn't, and you're holding, I once again repeat, these investments in joint names, in the very near future, it will cost you absolutely nothing to transfer out of your joint investment into two separate investments. It may be into one investment, depending upon one's tax position. Now, I don't want to overwhelm you. The legislation must be finally approved, but it won't be very long before, as I said, stamp duty will be abolished. That's going to be a great thing for the state of New South Wales, and from the personal point of view, as I mentioned, a great thing for people who want to change the style of their investment. That's the right way to express it. Think carefully about what I've said, and I'll see you next Monday.
Washington Fitness Centre today, 28-year-old Erica, the second best in the world in the under 52 kilogram division, was hard at it. She's only been seriously bodybuilding for about 2.5 years. Her recent performance in the World Championship is her best to date, but she has previously finished well up in other international competitions. Erica is certainly a dedicated sportswoman.
Thank you,
Ray.
Having a body, a dream body. Because every woman dreams about, you know, having a top body. But the good thing is going to the gym, staying on a good balanced diet, keeps you fit and healthy. But I,
could it be said it's the sort of ultimate ego trip to be in the mirror all the time?
The mirror? Yes. I look in the mirror all the time, you know, how I'm improving, you know. And I think I do pretty, pretty well. I'm very proud of myself. I think you know that I have two children, you know, and a husband, so it keeps me very busy at home. But I still enjoy coming to the gym.
The Harley Medical Centre in Sydney charges $1,500 for the treatment, which employs a technique known as chemical face peeling. A solution containing phenyl or carbolic acid is applied to the face, which is then covered with strips of surgical tape. The tape remains in place for 48 hours. It's then removed and the superficial layers of old skin peeled away with it.
The
director of the Sydney clinic, who declined to be named for ethical reasons, claimed although the treatment can't stop aging, it can make patients look 10 years younger. However, not all skin types respond to the treatment, and because of the use of carbolic acid, there are circumstances under which it isn't recommended.
There are some circumstances, a person that has severe heart disease or liver disease or kidney disease.
Because of the risk of scarring, the treatment isn't recommended to the eyelids or the neck. But isn't this where the worst signs of ageing show?
They certainly do occur around the eye, and they've tightened up there with the treatment. We do not do the neck because of the scarring, and if a person needs the neck done, then they need a surgical facelift.
Nevertheless, two women who have already undergone the treatment in Australia swear by the results.
I was considering cosmetic surgery because I was getting really desperate about the lines in the face, and then I saw the ads like about this facial rejuvenation.
How much do you think is mental attitude?
I don't think it's really a mental attitude. I do know that I feel 100% better because I was embarrassed when I was going out because I just thought everybody was looking at the lines in my face. But now I don't worry at all. I'm quite happy.